So get this, the media, they actually admit the Zack Snyder cut is a superior version of the Justice League, but, there always has to be that but, right? But it sets a dangerous precedent. Why? Because apparently the consumers that wanted it, the consumers that knew it existed, they bullied Warner Brothers into making it. They used the word bully, by the way, literally. You know, consumers going out wanting this stuff from AT&T, a company worth over $400 billion. Yeah, apparently that makes you some type of monster. Oh, man, don't these folks ever get tired of being wrong? So hey there to you, by the way. Now, we're looking at this. I mean, it amazes me the way that this article comes together. The new cut of the Justice League, dubbed the Snyder Cut by fans on the internet, it lasts 4 exhausting hours. But Snyder uses his double runtime wisely. Whereas Whedon's version gestured at vague, tear-jerky backstories, Snyder gives each hero personal stakes, particularly Ray Fisher's Cyborg. His strained relationship with his father becomes the much-needed heart of the film. The villain Steppenwolf, too, gets a motive, redeeming himself to his villainous family. The CGI battles look better. They're longer and bloodier, if that's your thing. No longer tonally bipolar. The film is one man's vision for better or worse. It's uniformly dark, and not just figuratively. Snyder's transformed several daytime scenes into murky nighttime ones, points for consistency, if not visual clarity. And he said he's going to donate some of those proceeds to suicide prevention programs. So like I said, the media, they're admitting that this is a superior version of the movie, but they're telling you this thing, it shouldn't have existed at all. Why? Because fans, they bullied that money out of Warner Brothers, and that money, it could have gone for something better, you know, better than listening to toxic fandom. So Snyder turned a bad movie into a less bad movie. In the beer bug, where blockbusters are scarce, maybe that's welcome. But the journey here was fraught. A group of fans operating under the banner hashtag release the Snyder Cut bullied Warner Brothers. Again, that kills me to see that wording. You have a company, like I was saying, under AT&T that is worth over $400 billion. And people operating a hashtag online, they're called bullies. Is that the world that we live in? Yeah, of course. You have the media spinning that stuff as bullying. If you go out, you pursue something that you want, and you actually get it. So they bully them into giving Snyder $70 million to remake the film. That's chump change for a superhero movie. But, again, here's another but. It could have funded a lovely new original. So, of course, you know, you can tell. These people, they didn't want this thing. So, of course, they'll never understand wanting to get it. This wasn't a quaint letter-writing campaign. While some fans innocently used the hashtag in hopes of getting a better movie, a toxic contingent spammed producers, critics, and fans of the rival Marvel Cinematic Universe with angry comments, and of course, they're going to be threats. I love how they say this all the time, by the way. Critics out there, those people, they were getting threats. Critics, they call you toxic. They attack you at every move, but that kind of stuff, that's just criticism. You reacting to that, reacting negatively like that, oh man, that's you attacking somebody. By capitulating to fans who employ dubious tactics to get what they want, Warner Brothers may have set a dangerous precedent. If this is the future of filmmaking, who's really in control? You know who's in control, by the way? You really want to ask that question. It's the people that pry open their wallets and they pay for something. I mean, if you want to get down to that and you want to say, hey, I don't want to listen to the consumer, well, woe be it to you. You're going to end up just like a place like Time here. They're going to beg you every time that you want to look at an article, they're going to beg you to pay $1. I mean, that's the place that we're at. But of course, you know, who's really in control? You got to wrestle that away. Make sure that you put those people in their place. Now, from there, they decide that they're going to expand this. They're going to say, oh, this stuff, it didn't operate in a vacuum. They're going to go after Zack Snyder. They're not going to limit it to Snyder either. They're also going to go after Ben Affleck. They're going to go after Gal Gadot because they share that problematic hashtag. And then Zack Snyder, well, he took up for those fans. And of course he did, because that's his future culture in filmmaking. Again, they attack somebody because they know who exactly supports them. They know their consumers. And well, like I said, that's a problem. And of course, that's why the media here, they're being outdone by people that are sitting in their houses with microphones. You know, because most people, they don't want to listen to this kind of trash anymore. But those fans, they didn't operate in a vacuum. Snyder encouraged them by creating social media accounts dedicated to what his version would have looked like. He used the hashtag himself, as did stars Ben Affleck and Gal Gadot. Snyder has said he refuses to watch the Whedon version. Hey, I don't blame him on that, by the way. Not only because of the version, but because of the way that WB and the way that Whedon pretty much treated the project and Zach Whedon by extension, and he maintained that most of his fans, with whom rests the future of his filmmaking career, are not toxic. Now, when you look at this stuff, this is an unabashed, unapologetic attack on not just consumers, but it's an attack on Zack Snyder. It's an attack on his career. And you tell me, when you look at something like this, who's the toxic one, really? Is it the fans that wanted not just a superior version of a movie, but the movie they were promised all along? Or is it the media that wants to not only attack them, but wants to end Zack Snyder because he didn't walk lockstep? I would say you can tell who's the bully in this stuff, but hey, you know, what do I know? See, what the media is going to do is they're going to attach claims of racism, they're going to attach claims of sexism, of phobia, while also telling you, of course, Ray Fisher, oh man, this made his role better. Fans actually like that. Oh, you know Gal Gadot over there, you know that female? Ah, fans, they wanted more of her, but of course, you know, racists and sexists. The ugliest subset of these fans fetishize the good old days when heroes were primarily white, straight, and male. Where did that come from, by the way? Oh, it just came right out of their imagination. Because really, when we get down to it, the media, they are bigots, they are racists, they are sexist, they are phobic. They just don't want to admit it, you know, because of course, this is pretty much their body armor. Some seek to protect that nostalgic but exclusionary version of storytelling at all costs. Then they drop the pretense and they out and out call people that wanted this trolls. Trolls within other fandoms have deployed the same toxic tactics as the Snyder Cut fans to drive women and people of color offline. Wait a minute, when did that happen again? How exactly is supporting Ray Fisher, how exactly is supporting Gal Gadot driving women and people of color offline? Well, hey, you just need to go with that. Then they start talking about, of course, Gamergate. They've got to talk about Star Wars. I mean, you look at the way that this stuff comes up. Has nothing. I mean, nothing to do with that. But time, of course, they need a story about toxicity. So, hey, they're never going to stop. They end with this, though. Greenlighting films based on fan campaigns may sound like the democratic way to make movies. But in reality, the power is not with the people, but with a small, loud contingent of fans willing to spew hatred. The Snyder Cut, new and improved as it may be, is the latest reward for their bad behavior. Huh, I see. Now, of course, time is going to take this stance, because time, they don't listen to consumers. And that's why they're being outdone by people on YouTube. So yeah, you can take your advice from someone like this, but hey, when you get failure from it, don't blame the consumer, right? But anyway, let me know what you think about this stuff. I mean, it doesn't surprise me, but it is a baffling mindset. Everybody that wants something is toxic, but because of course they are. But anyway, like I say, let me know what you think about this. Want to help out the channel? There are links in the description. And as always, appreciate the heck out of you. And yeah, I'm going to end here. Wow, what a mess.